Good morning, interweb. Let's world build.
Earth's crust is broken up into fragments. Carried along by currents in the upper mantle, these fragments, aka plate tectonics, move relative to one another. As a result, various landforms are created at the boundaries where these plates meet. Which landforms exactly? Well, that depends on what type of plates we got and what direction they're moving in. Plates can either be continental or oceanic. Continental plates are thick, felsic in composition, and have relatively low densities, whereas oceanic plates are thin, mafic in composition, and have relatively high densities. Plate boundaries come in three flavors: convergent, plates coming together; divergent, plates moving apart; and transform plate boundaries, plates sliding past one another. An oceanic continental convergent boundary looks like this. As the plates collide, the denser oceanic plate is forced under the more buoyant continental plate. Features created here are a subduction zone, aka a deep ocean trench, earthquakes, mountains, and volcanoes. Think the west coast of South America. An oceanic-oceanic convergent boundary looks somewhat similar, except everything is happening underwater. Expect to find ocean trenches, earthquakes, smallish mountains in the form of island arcs, and volcanoes. Think the Philippines. The final convergent boundary is continental-continental. Here both plates are composed of buoyant rocks, so neither will want to fully subduct, causing a lot of folding, faulting, and buckling, which will lead to the creation of very big mountains and a ton of earthquakes. Think the Himalayas. Then there's the two divergent plate boundary subtypes. Oceanic-oceanic divergent boundaries look something like this. As the plates pull apart, they get thinned out, and rising mantle material will push the plates upwards, forming a ridge. Magma will begin seeping out of the fault line and will form new crust. Expect to see a mid-ocean ridge, aka an underwater mountain range with a rift valley at its crest, earthquakes, and, where the ridge pops out of the water, volcanic islands. Think the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And the continental-continental divergent boundary is kinda the same thing, except everything's happening on land. Think the East African Rift Valley. Now, in theory, you could have an oceanic-continental divergent boundary, but given that new crust is created at divergent boundaries, your oceanic-continental divergent boundary will quickly become an oceanic-oceanic boundary. And finally, the two transform boundary subtypes. The most common example of a transform boundary is continental-continental. Think the San Andreas Fault. Expect earthquakes. Oceanic-oceanic transform boundaries are kinda cool. They occur alongside divergent boundaries. If we look at the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, we see that the divergent boundaries are offset at intervals by transform faults. This happens as a natural consequence of plate motion around the sphere. And like before, expect earthquakes. So there you go, all the plate boundary subtypes and their associated structures. Bear this table in mind because we're going to use this information to create a believable fantasy map. Planets are three-dimensional objects, so I like to map in three dimensions. Many fantasy maps look great in 2D, but look weird when projected onto a sphere. As such, my method requires two main programs, Photoshop and Gplates. That said, you could just as easily achieve everything I'm about to do by drawing on a piece of paper and the ball. So I'm not going to give you the specifics of each program, I'm just going to give you my workflow. I like to start off with an initial concept. In this case, I'm going to aim to create a Pangaea-like supercontinent situated mainly in the northern hemisphere of my planet that has just begun to break apart. Aside from being limited by the dimensions of a piece of paper, fantasy cartographers often inadvertently create Earth clones, which is fine if that's what you're after, but I'm not, and this brief will prevent me from replicating Earth. Next, I create an equirectangular map of my world. That is to say, I go to Photoshop, create a 2:1 aspect ratio document, and overlay a 12x6 grid on it. Before proceeding, it's worth noting what distortions are present in an equirectangular projection. Namely, the closer you get to the poles, the more squished and elongated things will become. So with that in mind, I sketch in my plate boundaries until I get something that looks like this. For reference, Earth has about 7 to 8 major plates, about 10 minor plates, and a ton of microplates. Also, be aware that your left and right edges will need to match, because we're going to wrap this around a 3D globe in a bit. And try to ensure that no more than 3 plates interact at any given point. In practice, this means that all interaction points must either form single lines or T-shapes, not crosses. Links in the doobie-doo to a paper on this. With the plate boundaries in, I go to Gplates and check to see if everything looks good in 3D. Particularly at the poles. If needed, I do a bit of editing directly in Gplates until I get something that looks like this. I fixed the poles, and got rid of a few plates I thought weren't necessary. From here, I mark in which plates would be continental, show them with a dot, and oceanic, no dot. This is not to say that the dotted plates will be all land, rather they'll be predominantly land, and vice versa for the oceanic plates. Remember, Earth-like planets will need most of their surface to be covered in water, so pro tip, make your biggest plates oceanic, like the Pacific. Next, I mark in the main directions the plates will be moving. Best way of doing this is to find where your planet's mid-Atlantic ridge will be, the location where two or more major plates are separating, and try to imagine how all other plates will move in relation to these. Here's what I came up with. Basically, these fellas are separating, giving rise to a fledgling mid-ocean ridge, and are being met with resistance from the north and south. Awesome! Now the fun part, filling in the continents. Like so. Zero artistic ability needed here, we're going for function over form. And anyways, it's not like there's a shortage of YouTube tutorials on the artistic side of mapmaking. With the continents in, I now know exactly what's continental crust and what's oceanic crust. So I begin marking in what's happening at each boundary. Remember, plates don't just move side to side and up and down, they also rotate, which means that plates can be moving in different directions in different areas. So any conflicting directions here can be chalked up to rotational movement as long as it's consistent. Also, there definitely will be places where you'll be unsure as to what's going on. Don't worry, that is entirely natural. Expect some boundaries to feature a mixture of boundary types at various points, depending on their shape. Based on the landforms I expect to see at each boundary, I go ahead and throw down various islands. Islands can really help sell the believability of a world, so don't skimp on this stage. Note that I haven't included any coastal islands because we're focusing on plate tectonics, but you totally should. The more islands, the merrier. Oh, and make sure to include some volcanic hotspots. Hotspots are not tied to plate boundaries and can occur anywhere on a plate. In the ocean, hotspots will give rise to volcanic island arcs. Magma breaks through an area of relatively thin crust and a volcano is formed. As the plate moves over this hotspot, newer volcanic islands will form and the older ones will cool, subside and erode, forming older, smaller islands and atolls. Think the Hawaii island chain. FYI, hotspots can also develop under continents, forming large calderas. Yellowstone is a good example of this. So let's go with a Hawaii-like island chain here, and boom, map done. To finish off, I bring this back into Photoshop and create an elevation map to show where my mountains will be. Note that I've also included the continental shelf, the area of seabed around the landmass where the sea is relatively shallow compared with the deep ocean. As always, I use the table and the plate boundaries to guide me. As a final optional step, I use GProjector, another free cross-platform application, to make and export many different projections of my world. Here, have a heart-shaped map as a thanks for listening to me espouse the virtues of tectonically informed fantasy cartography. Good morning, Interweb. So if there's any interest in me doing an in-depth tutorial on how to use Photoshop and GPlates, let me know in comments. Just be aware that that would mean some very lengthy, very screen share style videos. So I need to know if y'all are cool with that before I go ahead with it. As always, thank you so much for watching and special thanks go out to Isaac Silbert, Andrew Shahail, Robin Hilton, World Anvil and Ripta Passe. You folks are all of the awesome. Thank you. And until next time, Edgar out.